Welcome, everybody. This is Rabbi Malik, as you know, from Temple Beth Am in Aberdeen, New Jersey. And I am absolutely honored and touched that Hessy Taft has agreed to speak with us this evening. Hessy Levinsons Taft came to the United States when she was just 15 years old. She studied at Barnard College and Columbia University, obtained both her BA and her MA in chemistry, married Earl Taft, a research professor of mathematics at Rutgers University, the most brilliant couple I know. The Tafts lived in Princeton, New Jersey with their kids, Nina and Alex, and Nina is right there with her mom, Hessy. Nina and I went to college together, and Nina has co-authored some papers and worked on some projects with Adi, so we have lots of connections, and we've been bridesmaids in each other's weddings, all kind of stuff. The Tafts, it was not just Earl and Hessy, it's Nina and Alex, and they grew up in Princeton. Earl and Hessy raised Nina and Alex in Princeton, and Hessy spent many years working at ETS, the Educational Testing Service, overseeing university entrance exams in chemistry and biology. So some of you, depending on your age, if you're my age or a little bit older, you might remember filling out by hand these forms for the SATs and the subject matter tests, and they were mailed to ETS in Princeton. That was Hessy. Later on, Hessy joined St. John's University in Queens as an adjunct faculty member. And she has spent the past 20 years researching and publishing papers about global water sustainability. And she did so while working closely with faculty at Ben-Gurion University in Israel. And it's very fitting that we have Hessy speaking today, not only because of Yom HaShoah, but because Hessy is, like I am, an ardent Zionist and very proud to have connections to Israel. Hessy also volunteered for 2 decades, 20 years, at the Museum of Natural History in Manhattan. And she gave tours, not in English, but in French. A few years ago, Hessy and Earl moved to San Francisco to live closer to their 2 children and their 4 beautiful grandchildren. Without further ado, I'm going to remove my spotlight and put spotlight on Hessy and Nina.
Can you see her? There we go. Okay. Can you hear me now?
We can hear you. Terrific.
Okay, great. Well, first of all, I want to thank Lisa. I want to thank you for hosting me in your synagogue. And like you, I am an ardent Zionist. And so we have that in common. And I'd love the opportunity to tell yet one more story of how anti-Semitism has overpowered the world.
Let's start with your baby picture first.
So let me get the baby. Do you have the picture?
Lisa might have them. That's just I think.
Lisa, do you have the pictures?
I'll get the picture right now. Give me a moment.
All right. See, I can't. I'm on a different device, and I don't think I don't have the pictures here. Okay. Just start telling the story, Mom.
Start talking, and then I'll show the picture as you start speaking.
Well, the first picture is a picture of my parents in Berlin. I was born in Berlin during the Hitler era, the daughter of Latvian Jews who went to Germany to study. They went to Germany to study voice, but my father couldn't contract. Hello?
Just keep talking, they can hear you.
There you go. That's great. That's a picture of my parents in Berlin at the time of my birth. And I was born at a time when they didn't allow them to have careers as Jews. So my father started in business. And when I was got a very nice apartment on Augsburger Straße in Berlin, and when I was about 6 months old or so, they decided, like all proud parents, I guess, to take me to a photographer to have a picture taken. And they did, and put it on the piano, which my father had bought my mother for my mother when I was born. Some weeks later, the cleaning lady came up and said, you know, Paul Livingston, I saw your baby's picture in the magazine. And my mother said, that's impossible. She said, no, give me the money and I'll bring you the photo. And sure enough, she went downstairs and came back with a magazine. Do you have the picture, the photo, baby picture?
The next picture.
Yes, give me a moment.
Anyway,
just keep talking now.
Okay, so they took the next picture, and sure enough, it was my picture was on the cover of a magazine published out of Leipzig, the only Nazi magazine allowed to circulate at the time. It said Sonne ins Haus, which means the sunshine in the home. And it had inside all kinds of Hitler paraphernalia, including the Führer himself reviewing the troops, a bad play, his favorite music, the Hitler Jugend drumming, practicing. There we go. That's the picture which my mother was horrified to see on the Nazi magazine. Of course, it had immediate repercussions. My mother went to the photographer and said, what happened here? And the photographer took my mother to a back room and said, come here, I'll tell you. There was a contest run by Goebbels' propaganda ministry, directly from the Ministry of Propaganda, of the 10 best photographers in Germany to submit the 10 best pictures. He was very prominent and was one of the 10 selected. And he said, and you see, I submitted your baby's picture. We're not quite there yet.
Yeah, we can wait, we can hold off on the pictures for a few minutes.
So he said, my mother was horrified to hear that. He submitted my picture and said, but you know, this is a Jewish child. And he said in German, which I was told never to forget, ja, aber ich wollte mir den Spaß erlauben. I wanted to allow myself the pleasure of this joke. So my mother went home, and of course my parents were horrified. The immediate consequence was that I could not go out to the playground anymore, which my Aunt Masha used to take me to all the time, because I was beginning to talk. And if I had told anybody my name, Levinsons, I wouldn't be sitting here today. Also, my auntie died.
The contest was supposed to pick an Aryan baby. Right?
Yeah, Nina points out that the contest was to pick out, of course, I should have mentioned that, the contest run by the ministry was to pick out the perfect Aryan baby, the Zonane's house. And they picked me as a Jewish child to be the perfect Aryan baby. Anyway, the consequences were enormous, and I don't have time now to tell you all the details. I'll just mention one. My aunt lived in Vilna, and she went to a card store, baby store, looking for a first birthday card for me to send me to Berlin. And she found my baby picture on the birthday cards. Among the birthday cards, it said, Herzliche Geburtstag, his heartiest congratulations to the birthday. Well, my aunt went up to the cashier and said, where did you get this card? And the cashier said, oh, it's not a doll. It's a real baby. It's a Berliner baby. So my aunt just bought it and sent it to us in an envelope. We have both the original birthday card and one of the three copies that my mother took out of her with her from Germany when we left. As you can see, that copy was folded. So she had three copies, the birthday card, and the one copy were donated to the U.S. Holocaust Museum. And the other one, which I proudly was able to give to Yad Vashem in Israel. After things got pretty bad in Berlin, my father got arrested on mock charges. One of his accountants was in his office, and the accountant followed him in a typical Hollywood style chase, car chase, banged into the police station and said, I vouch for this man, Heil Hitler. And my father was released at that time. It was also just shortly after my sister was born. And my parents decided it was time to leave Germany. Even though the Latvian consulate told us to stay, he said, if there's a madman, when I leave, you can leave. He won't last. Anyway, my parents decided to leave. So we left Berlin and spent the winter in Latvia, visiting our family. My father set up business in Paris. In 1938, we moved to Paris. And then there was a very, Paris was okay in 38. But as we all know, it fell in June 1940. In the summer of 1939, though, my mother and father had a famous argument, famous in the same sense that it persisted our family life, all my life. The argument was, my mother said, I'm taking the kids to see my mother.
In Latvia.
My father said, you can't cross Germany by train these days. It's too dangerous. My mother insisted, I won't get involved with politics. I'll just play with the kids. My father said, the kids speak German. You'll get caught. You cannot go to Germany. So we did not. Fortunately, my father won the argument because that summer, can I have the next picture, please, the two little kids? That summer, we decided to stay in Paris. That's it. And this picture is remarkable for one particular place. It was taken, the back of it is dated August 20th, 1939. That is 11 days before Hitler marched into Poland. Every one of our family who was caught on the other side of Poland was killed. All my cousins, all my aunts, all my uncles on the other side were killed. I would not have, had we gone to Latvia, we would have been among the millions of innocent children that were sent to concentration camps and died in the Holocaust. The innocent children like Noemi and me. Noemi was my sister's name, is my sister's name. She now lives in Los Angeles. Okay, so we settled in Paris. And there, my parents picked up a very lovely apartment in the Rue de Bissy near the park. Also, and we got very, as you may know, in France, the nice apartment buildings. I had supers, which are called concierge, that lived on the ground floor and sort of supervised people coming in and out of the building. My father had a childhood friend living in Paris called George. And as fate would have it, well, I should point out that the concierge was particularly fond of George. So one fateful Sunday afternoon, as we were walking out of the building, my father said to the concierge, "Goodbye, madame. Oh, we're going to visit George this afternoon." And so she said, "Have a good time." Very innocuous common exchange. Except that a couple of hours later, the phone rang at George's house, and it was a concierge who advised us not to go back to the apartment. The Nazis came looking for us to round us up, and they said they'll be back. So that night, my parents made a decision that my mother, my sister, and I would be sent to the south of France, where the Vichy government was not cooperating with the Germans. The free zone near Montmartre, near Bordeaux, at a place called Montmartre. My father stayed at the, slept on the couch in George's house and took the risk of going back frequently to our apartment to pack things up. He was particularly anxious to pack up the three paintings that I had from, that my mother had from her father, who was a cousin in Latvia and also a very renowned painter. Not renowned in the sense of popular, but as a Jew, but renowned in the sense that he painted, was asked to paint the Tsarevich of the royal family in Russia. Anyway, back to the apartment in Paris, my father, of course, wanted to salvage the piano, the photos, the baby picture,
the magazines,
which my mother wanted to take with her, and a lot of other memorabilia that he bought in Germany. I mean, Germany and France. And when it was all done, he packed it up and had it shipped and stored in Lisbon, because that was, as you know, Franco was aligned with Hitler, but my father could get this to ban, stuck, stored in Lisbon. Okay, meanwhile, my sister and my mother and I were in this pension outside of Bordeaux, and we had a lot of difficult moments there with people wanted to get rid of us, etc. But again, there are many interesting stories. I'll just focus on one. One day, my mother took us to the beach, and we were playing at the beach when suddenly a German officer came by, and he heard Noemi and me speaking German. So he went up to my mother and he said to her, "Die Kinder sprechen Deutsch," which means the kids speak German. And my mother said, "Yes, we used to have a governess who spoke German to them, but we don't anymore." So he came up to us, Noemi and me. Noemi was 3 and I was 5. And he looked at us and he said, "What's your name?" And Noemi answered back, "Noemi Levinsons." And he said, "What? Levin?" She said, and she pointed out like he was an idiot, didn't understand. "Yes, Levinsons," emphasizing it.
Yeah.
The soldier just got up and told my mother to come with him to the police station because she could be very useful as a translator. And my mother said, oh, I'm very bad at that. I don't know how to translate. I can't do that. I could never be of any use to you in that regard. So again, fate played a very important role. Fate, you may call it, or God, as I like to think of it. The guy, the Nazi, looked at me and looked at the kids and looked at my mother, and he said, okay, I'll let you go this time, but I'll be back. Things got worse and worse at the pension. And eventually, we were told to leave. And that very night, again, fate played in our hand. That very night was the night that my father drove out and left Paris, driving all night without stopping, took other than gas, and drove and drove until he arrived in the middle of the morning at the pension, again saving our lives from a departure, from separation, permanent separation. Because if my mother and my sister and I had gotten thrown out of that pension, where would she go with two kids and a suitcase? Anyway, I'm walking on the road. Anyway, we were saved. My father found a mechanism by a French resistance officer who took a bunch of Jews in his meat truck and drove us. The goal was to reach Nice. He drove us to a certain spot when he told us that we all have to get out because this is a very dangerous crossing with German soldiers on the road ahead, and they were going to insist on opening the truck. So he let us out and told us to cross the forest and be very quiet, because if he didn't, if the Germans in the forest heard us, we'd be finished. So he made a threat, which I never forgot in my life. He took out this knife, and he said, see this knife, anybody who makes a sound, I will cut off their tongue. I was petrified. My mouth locked all the way across. For the little kids, like Noemi and smaller, they had gotten some chocolates, which they fed the little kids, the babies. But I was too old to get the chocolate, so I had to bear the threat and run into the forest with a friend of my father's. He told me this was a sport, and I was horrified. It was one of the most terrifying experiences of my life. When we did get to the other side, the truck was there and picked us up. And eventually got us to Nice. In Nice, things, there was very... these things were very tough too. There were rations and so on. But the interesting thing that happened there was my father had a friend in Paris who checked our mail, and he saw that we had gotten a big fat envelope from the Department of State of the United States. He said it looked like a visa, so my father asked him to send it to us. And indeed, when he got it, it was an immigration visa to the United States. But it had a clause, a caveat. It says, this visa is valid for 90 days after issuance. It is now not valid beyond 90 days of its issuance. When my father opened the envelope and received it, he saw that 45 days had gone by. There was no way he could arrange to come to the United States within 45 days. Remember, there were no commercial flights. And Jenny, the Atlantic was mined. He would have to try to find a circuitous route through South America. And he knew he couldn't make it in 1945 days. So he wired Washington for asking for an extension. And it came back with a stamp saying denied. So I want all the listeners to know that it's not thanks to Uncle Sam that I'm sitting here today. The US turned us down in our most dire need. My father, the eternal optimist and clever, brilliant as he was, decided to go to all the South American embassies asking for visas. He had some money. He was willing to bribe them. Nobody except Cuba was willing to accept the money, the bribe that my father offered him. And gave us four visas.
Maybe we should stop there and take questions.
It was at that time that we managed eventually to get to Marseille, and back to from Marseille to Lisbon, crossing Spain, which was dangerous because Spain was allied with Hitler. But we made it to Portugal, and we sailed on the next to the last boat out of Europe at the beginning of 1942. The ship was Ser Papinto, and it was packed with refugees, packed with mat. The whole hull of the boat was covered with mattresses for refugees. Eventually, we arrived in Cuba and started a difficult life there for my father again to start all over again.
Can you stop and ask questions?
I think I'll stop here because if anybody wants to know more about Cuba, I'll be glad to answer questions. But our escape out of the Holocaust from Europe is something that needs to be remembered. And Yom HaShoah is a perfect time to remember how many millions of Jews were badly treated, were slaughtered because they had no defense. So I grew up a very strong Zionist because I believe that the Jews' ancient homeland is where Jews belong. And if you can't actually go to, if you can't actually live there, you should support Israel no matter what the government is. That doesn't mean everything about Israel is perfect, but it still means that Israel is our homeland. And I believe should be valued and not judged by outsiders who don't know what the history is. I think
we're running over schedule, so if we want to move to questions, maybe this is the right time, Lisa and others.
Yeah. Okay, Nina, before, Hessy, thank you so much for sharing at least part of your story. I do want to know the other photos that we have. Would you like me to share those as well? Because I stopped at the picture of you and your sister
yes.
Paris, so I can show you the photos as well.
Just explain these quickly.
This is a picture of me in our apartment in Paris, in Havana, where we eventually really had a wonderful time. We were very much accepted in Cuba. They didn't know much about Jews. They welcomed us, so the Catholics welcomed us heartily. I'm showing you the next.
Yeah. Oops, nope, other direction.
The other way. There's one picture. There's one picture taken in New York at a Seder. Can you show that?
Yeah, give me a moment. I'm getting it. Here we go.
Okay, it doesn't matter.
I think so. I saw somebody had a question about when and how you left Cuba. I think I saw that coming in on the chat.
We left Cuba.
Yeah, there's a question from Sandy Finkelstein. How did and when did you leave Cuba?
This is a picture of the Seder and my family in New York. My parents, my father's in the background, and our two grandchildren are their two grandchildren, our two children are next to my father. There's Nina and Alex with bushy hair. Mm-hmm. By the way, I should say that Rabbi Malik married Alex and his wife.
That's right.
Also, next to Alex
is you.
And I, next to me, is Earl, my husband. And next to my husband is my dear Aunt Marsha. And next to me is my mother in our New York apartment, which we enjoyed after we arrived. This is the picture of me at Yad Vashem when I donated the second copy. Proudly donated. It is in Yad Vashem. I should point out that my giving this picture to Yad Vashem, the German newspaper Bild, picked up a story and made it viral so that people are now all over the world currently still sending me pictures and that they want me to autograph. I'm selective of what I do.
I just have to add that if you go to Google and you type in the perfect Aryan baby was Jewish, you'll get many, many hundred hits in articles in lots of different languages.
One interesting thing about Cuba, about how we came here, my father became acting president of the Bnei Brit in Cuba. There were a bunch of Jewish exiles who built up a synagogue. And the Bnei Brit was part of it. He had made a contact with American Bnei Brits, but he labored heavily to meet with Cuban diplomats to get Cuba's vote for partition in 1937.
47.
For partition, United Nations vote. They promised him they would vote for, but at the last minute they reneged. So Cuba did not actually vote for partition.
So I will just add that my mom and her family got visas to come to the United States in 1949, after Israel was created, when the US was more generous with giving visas to Jews because they were no longer afraid of an onslaught of immigrants since Israel was another option. And I think my grandfather wanted to move to New York so his daughters would marry Jews.
And they both did.
There weren't so many options in Cuba. Any other questions?
I actually had one question before we transition to the ceremony part of our program. I should let everybody know that this is the second time at least that I know of that Hessy spoke and told her story. Just last week was it? Hessy told her story to a congregation in the Boston area. And one of the questions that was asked there was about the role of your father. And what you mentioned, he was brilliant, and he was the one who was able to bribe the Cuban officials. Tell us a little bit more about your dad and what role he played in your escape.
How can I describe my father? He was a hero. He was bright, clever, very, very resourceful, very devoted to his family. And he's my role model. Whenever something happens, I turn to guys to hear what he would have done. I will say this much. I told both my kids in growing up that the only reason they're growing up safely as American Jews that are not being discriminated like in Europe is because there exists a state of Israel. Their diaspora Jews are protected by the fact that there is now a prime minister that can visit other countries and is respected like a human being instead of being shoved around everywhere.
I think, Lisa, the thing that my grandfather had to start over again three times in life. You know, he wanted to be an opera singer and then he had to become a businessman. And when he moved to Cuba, he started a new business. When he moved to New York, he started a new business. And every time he was successful. So I think this is in part why we all have such, you know, he got the visas for them. He got them out of Europe. He got them out of Paris in time. He got them out of Berlin in time. Every step of my mom's story was my grandfather's decision-making. That's why we all have such tremendous reverence for him.
What was his name, Nina and Hessy?
Jacob Levinsons.
Jacob Levinsons. Okay. May his memory be for a blessing.
Thank you.
Thank you, Hessy, and thank you, Nina, for sharing your story. And I hope I'll get to see you in person soon, one day. And you're welcome to join us for the rest of the program this evening, or take a break and come back. Keep your video on, off, but really, thank you. Thank you. Not enough words to say.
Thank you, Lisa. Thank you very much. And thank the whole congregation for your interest in preserving history.
Thank you. Wow. Aren't that many Holocaust survivors left in this world to tell their stories, and people who escaped from the Holocaust as well. We are now going to move on with our program so we can memorialize those who perished, the 6 million who perished. Let me show you the program here. Ooh, let me put this in a better mode. Okay, so give me a thumbs up if you can see the program. So you get a sense of where we are and where we're going. Okay, so I have some visuals. We're going, so a short video with the song Oif and Pripichik, the last butterfly poem by Pavel Friedman, who was in Theresienstadt, three original poems by three teenagers in our community who wrote it while they wrote their poems while they were in the religious school, David Juris, Zoe Lieb, and Adam Lirov. David Juris's grandmother is on the call today, is on Zoom, and she is a survivor of Bergen-Belsen. That's Mimi Bergenfeld. We also will then be looking at some names from the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum. We have an introductory reading before we share the list of names of Temple Beth Am congregants' relatives who perished during the Holocaust. And you can see the names of the speakers there, Max Butkovic, Corey Shannon, Zoe Lieb, Adam Lirov, Abby Cohen, and Seth Arbitol. And it's a bunch of Hebrew high school teens, and then Seth Arbitol. Why Seth Arbitol? Because as president of the men's club, it's the men's club that we have to thank for the Yom HaShoah candles that were sent to each of our homes during, even during the pandemic. And God willing, some of you will be able to light yours tonight if you didn't have a chance to light it last night. There were some beautiful readings in there as well, so that's why Seth will be reading. I'll be scrolling through names of Temple Beth Am members' relatives who perished during the Holocaust, sharing some other photos. Then we have some other readers who are going to read excerpt from Eli Wiesel's poem called Ani Ma'amin. Ani Ma'amin, two words mean I believe, and it's based on a song, Ani Ma'amin, that's based on words that the Rambam, Maimonides, wrote. I believe with a perfect faith in the coming of the Mashiach, and even if he takes a long time to get here, I will still wait. And these are our readers: Joanne Abraham, Ann Schumann, Murray Mark, Lori Tabor, Freda Shaw, Carol Hinkes, Betty Ann Honig, Alice Grun, and Danielle Leroff. Then I'll show you an Animamin clip of a video sung by Dudu Fischer at Auschwitz-Birkenau March of the Living ceremony in 2015. And then we'll have our memorial prayer, El Malei Rachamim, Mourner's Kaddish, and a clip of Zognik Kainwall by Hirsch Glick with a sound clip. And we will then continue with Mari in our Sidur, Sim Shalom for Weekdays, page 137. So let me continue now. I just want to do a better version of my share screen. Hopefully I'll be able to deal with this tech glitch. Here we go. Nope. One more time. Here we go. Ooh, that's my phone.
You need to unmute.
Okay, I am unmuted now, and I think I have everything that I need on the screen. Okay.
Come on.
Az ir vet kinderlang alter waren, wat ir alleen nog staat.
Okay, if the Hebrew High School teens could get on deck now, you'll be doing your original poems after the next few slides. Give me a moment. Okay, David, let me unmute David. There we go. One moment, David, I see you and your mom. Let me spotlight you also. You need to unmute yourself. I just gave you a permit. Okay, and let me just spotlight you. Okay, David, go ahead.
Yeah. Okay, just double checking if everyone can hear me. Everyone can hear me. Okay, good. Should I say my name in the title of the poem?
Go ahead.
Okay. I don't need this. It's up on the screen. Okay. I am from by me. From now and on, I am from this horrible enclosed place. The place where no one is treated well. The place where all I see is death. I am from the suffering of my family, the hoping that it will end soon. I am from the love of my family, even in these hard times. I am from keeping traditions as much as we can and trying to stay alive. I am from whatever this is, proud to still be standing. I am Jewish from the moment of my birth to when the gun was pointed at my head, at me and my family. I am here.
Zoe?
Hundreds of thousands of Jews were killed. 1 in 7 escaped to find refuge, but many sat still. Losers and traitors were what we were called. Outcasts and strangers were how we were saw. Chambers filled with gas suffocated Jews in concentration camps. All hope was lost in the eyes of the Jews, for we had to wear yellow-starred stamps. United and apart from all we were kept, starvation and hunger and painful ways of death. These were all the suffers and pains of Jews, but for now we are united again.
Adam?
So much hatred, so many lives, all this hatred, that's what drives. Drives these people down this road, where the Nazis are betrayed. And these people still stand, never rest, and never spare. What they scream and what they shout, we born from hatred and no doubt. And their hatred, born from fear, draw them in slavery. And it shouldn't matter what they say, and even more what they do. They live another day, no matter what they are, that's true. But we can stop it, we can do it. I hope it vanished from the soul. The hatred turns a person to his wall. The system is in fear.
We had some sound issues there, so I'm going to leave this on the screen for just a couple of moments so you have a chance to read it to yourself. And while you're reading, I just want to acknowledge Maura Shari Tosk. Maura Shari is our Dalit and Hay class teacher at Temple Beth Am Religious School. And I also want to acknowledge Maura Ann, who is the outstanding director of our religious school. These poems were written under the guidance of Maura Ann and Maura Shari as part of the Holocaust curriculum that is taught in sixth grade. These three students are already beyond sixth grade. They wrote this a few years ago, but I asked them to come back and to share these poems with us.
Believe.
to ask Max, Rekovic, Corey Shannon, Zoe Lieb, Adam Lirov, Abby Cohen, and Seth Arbitol to get yourselves ready in position for your speaking parts, and I'll make this larger. Okay, Max, you're on.
We shall not forget all the parents who are cruelly separated from their children.
We shall not forget all the parents who died with their children in their arms.
We shall not forget the helpless infants, children, and teenagers who were cut down like young trees before their time, before they had a chance to experience life.
We shall not forget the heroes of the resistance who fought the Nazis, so few against so many.
We shall not forget all of the rabbis who were among the first to be killed because they were the teachers of Torah.
We shall not forget any of those precious souls who were murdered, including many of the relatives of members of our congregation, Temple Beth Am.
This is Ani Mami. Thank you.
HaMashiach, Bebiyas HaMashiach, Ani Mami.
I'd like to acknowledge Alice Grun and Phyllis Brooks for putting together this beautiful booklet honoring the memory of the Jews of Hermann of Mestek and one of their Torah scrolls, the Torah scroll that we have been using the last couple of weeks and years since it's been on loan to us. We use it oftentimes as our Maftir Torah reading, as we did last Shabbat and on Sunday, on the last 2 days of Passover. And during Yizkor, this is the book from which I read the names of people who perished from this town. Now I'd like to ask our next group of readers to unmute yourselves when it's your turn. We'll start first with Joanne Abraham, then Ann Schumann, Murray Mark and Lori Tabor, Freda Shaw, then Carol Hinkes, Betty Ann Homig, Alice Grun, and Danielle Lerov. So let's start with Joanne.
A camp, an inmate. A creature without a name, a man without a face, without a destiny. It is night, the first night of Passover.
Camp is asleep. He alone is awake. He talks to himself soundlessly. Hear his words, capture his silence. To himself, to me, he is saying, I have not partaken of matzoth, not of maror.
Murray, Lori.
I have not emptied the four cups, symbols of the four deliverances. I did not invite the hungry to share my repast or even my hunger.
No longer have I a son to ask me the four questions. No longer. No longer.
No longer
I the strength to answer.
Freda?
Okay. The parable of Ashad Gada is misleading. God will not come to slay the slaughterer. The innocent victims will go unavenged.
Ancient wish, L'shana haba'a b'Yerushalayim, will not be granted. I shall not be in Jerusalem next year or anywhere else. Next year, I shall not be.
Still, I recite the Haggadah and I wait the prophet Elijah as I did long ago. I open my heart to him and say,
Ready, Ann? Ready, Ann, you need to unmute. Ready, Ann?
Welcome, prophet of the promise. Welcome, herald of redemption. Come share in my story. Come, rejoice with the dead that we are. Empty the cup that bears your name. Come to us.
Alice, unmute.
Come to us this Passover night. We are in Egypt, and we are the ones to suffer God's plagues.
Come, friend of the poor, defender of the oppressed. Come, and I shall wait for you. And even if you disappoint me, I shall go on waiting. Ani Mami.
Ready now for the memorial prayer. If you're in a place where you can stand up and you'd like to, please do. If you have a Yom HaShoah candle nearby, lit or unlit, and you'd like to hold it while we are doing this memorial prayer, please do. And we'll stay muted for this, but then I will unmute everybody for the mourner's kaddish. If everyone could mute themselves just for this part. Okay. And for the kaddish, we'll all do it together. El male rachamim shochen bamaromim hamtze menucha nechona tachat kanfe ha-shechina b'malot kedoshim u'tehorim kezohar harakia masirim et nishmot kol acheinu b'nei Yisrael anashim nashim v'taf shenehergu v'shenitbechu v'shenisrefu v'shenechneku b'gan Eden tehi menuchatam ana bal harachamim hastirem b'seter k'nefecha li'olamim utzror b'tzror hachayim et nishmotehem Adonai hu nachalatam v'yanuchu v'shalom al mishkevotehem v'nomar Amen. Exalted, compassionate God, grant perfect peace in your sheltering presence among the holy and the pure to the souls of all our brethren, men, women, and children of the house of Israel, who were slaughtered and burned. May their memory endure, inspiring truth and loyalty in our lives. May their souls thus be bound up in the bond of life. May they rest in peace, and let us say, Amen. If I could ask everyone who feels comfortable unmuting themselves to do so. Okay, I'm going to put on the special mourner's kaddish for the Holocaust. So I'd like everyone to remain muted. That didn't work so well the first time. But at least we did a full kaddish, which was wonderful. So if you'd like to say this with me using the words on the screen, so it's a little bit different than what you know. It's the same words in Hebrew and Aramaic, but interspersed with those words are names of concentration camps and other sites where horrific things happened to our people. Yitgadal, Auschwitz. Vyitkadash, Lodz. Shemei Rabah, Ponar, Bealma divra kirute, Babi Yar, Biamlich machute, Bechayechon uviomechon, Birkenau, Uvchaye zechol beit Yisrael,
Birkenau,
Bagala uvizman kariv,
Imru,
Amen.
Amen.
Yehe shme,
Mavara. The only,
only.
A Kafka.
Sorry about that. Yitbarach.
Yitbarach.
Be Shabach to raise and stab.
Raise
Be it Roma. Nase, be it Hadar.
Treblinka.
Yeah. V'chayim alinu
yimru amen. Hosteh shalom yimramav huyaseh shalom alinu
yimru kol Yisrael yimru
amen.
Listen, Stay on. I know some might have to leave, but we are going to do Mariv now, and there are several yurt sites being commemorated tonight, as well as people who are saying Kaddish. So today, during the day, on the 26th of Nisan, was the yurt site of Celia Pollock, mother of Marsha Lichtman, the yurt site of Florence Greensport, mother of Dale Golden, also the yurt sites of Alan Beach, Harold Metz, Henrietta Schoenberg, Herman Bernstein, father of Ray Ellen Mandelbaum, Linda Cohos, and Sina B. Benson. And tonight and tomorrow, the 27th of Nisan, are the yurt sites of Frank Rudnick, Louis Levine, David Grun, father-in-law of Alice Grun, Martha Grun, mother-in-law of Alice Grun, Sadie Kaplan, mother of Shelley Kaplan, Sadie Kaplan, grandmother of Melissa and Shari Kaplan as well, and Sylvia Berman, mother of Barbara Levine. So we're going to Davin Mariv, and we have others who are saying Kaddish as well, who will say the names of their loved ones when we get to the Mourner's Kaddish. So thank you everybody for joining us for the first two parts of our program. This is the last part of the program. It will be take about 15 minutes. Okay, and let me just put a link in the chat with the link to the page. I'm about to put it up. I didn't have it ready. Okay, so we're on page 137 of Sidur Sim Shalom. And I will, for those of you who don't have the Sidur at home or don't have a link, now I have it. Okay, Mari, will you lead us?
It'll be my honor. Who got me?